Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Very happy to welcome you here, to see so many faces. We never expected to see so many of you. Probably next time we'll have to find the other place, the stadium. This is quite iconic meeting, and this is probably happens for the first time when we have the meeting of two great conceptualists from US and from Russia, John Baldessari, Ilya Kabakov, and you can see it here in Moscow now. All that became possible due to the fact that the Center for Contemporary Culture Garage, since the 21st of September, exhibits the exhibition of John Baldessari, and we have already launched a multimedia exhibition Kabakov-Lisitsky, and it will be commented later on today. And this meeting is also important from the position of art, contemporary art, because this public talk would be moderated by the chief curator of the Center for Contemporary Culture Garage, Kate Fowle, sitting on the right to me, and on the left to me, this is Hans Ulrich Obrist, who is the international program advisor for Center for Contemporary Culture Garage. And all that would never be possible due to our great sponsors. This is Sotheby's and Credit Suisse, and many thanks for them for supporting and providing some support for us. And now I give the mic to Olga. So I may say that right now I was asked a question. What separates, what distinguishes Kabakov and Baldessari? But I would like to know more what unites them, because when it Tate Modern also retrospective exhibition of Baldessari, you see them. Baldessari, you can see him in many options in different halls, galleries, but in that retrospective project, the first thing I had was how it happened that starting from the end of 60s, the beginning of 70s, two artists, how was it possible that they could knew each other? Not possible, not possible at all. They were moving in common direction. They understood the reality from different realities, Californian and Russian reality, Soviet reality at that time, and how further on they invented that language for description, and how simultaneously they launched certain universal images and ideas that appeared to be very interesting to everybody, because you see, this is Kommunalka, this is not the reality of the former Soviet Union, where in one kitchen there were 15 different stoves and the neighbors tried to get some poison into neighbors' pot. You know, this is the reality, this is what we have in each soul of us, and this is how Baldessari, referring to the word, to the image, to what has been done, to all the languages, absolutely polyphonically works, how he described this mass production culture, mass consumption culture. It used to be not only there, but also here. They opened something common for us, and we never dreamt that Baldessari visits us. And I have to say many, many thanks to Garage. Of course, many thanks to Daria Zhukova, who organized and supported this wonderful story. Of course, Anton Belov and the whole team. Many thanks for Baldessari's visit. And, you know, we never discussed it before, we never agreed, but two great artists are now in this field together. And I won't take too much time from you, and let's give the floor to those who were so eagerly waited here. So many thanks to John and Ilya for having acceptance to this meeting. Now, Kate and Hans, the floor is yours.
So thank you, Olga, and thank you, Anton, for a wonderful introduction. I apologize in advance for speaking English, but you wouldn't understand my Russian at all. Anton told me I sounded like a robot when I said spasiba today. So I want to thank the House of Artists very much for hosting us. This is a wonderful place to be, and it's amazing seeing so many people here. I also want to thank Nastya Matushina and the whole of the Garage Education Department, because they have done their amazing stuff as usual. So I'm going to be quick with the introduction. I just want to give you a few facts about John and Ilya, just to kind of set the scene, and then we will get straight down to the conversation. So John was born in 1931 in National City. And Ilya was born in California, and Ilya was born in 1933 in, I've been practicing this, Dnipropetrovska. How was that? I told you I shouldn't speak Russian. So both of them have made over 100 solo exhibitions. John started exhibiting in 1957, and Ilya started in 1958. So you've actually been running parallel the whole time. John Baldessari has been in 6 Whitney biennials, 3 documentaries and 2 Venices. And he's had 4 retrospectives. The most recent was in 2009. And the work that you will see when his exhibition, 1+1=1, opens on Friday, is the work that he's made since then. So it's an incredible body of work, and I'm looking forward to welcoming lots of you there. Meanwhile, Ilya Kabakov moved to the United States in 1988, and he then married Emilia Kabakov, and they have been collaborating together since 1989. From 1988 to 1999, they made over 160 exhibitions together. Over 100 of those were installations. It's quite amazing how prolific they are. Ilya and Emilia were the first living artists to have an exhibition at the Hermitage in 2004. And next year, in case they hadn't done enough, they are embarking on their largest project to date, which is Monumenta in Paris. So a few things that they have in common, I worked out. They've both been working for over 50 years making art. Art News said that Ilya Kabakov was one of the 10 greatest artists living now. And Time magazine, I think yesterday, said that John Baldessari was a living legend. They exhibited together for the very first time in 1989 in an exhibition called Magician de la Terre, and they did not meet. They then exhibited again for Global Conceptualisms in 1999, and they still didn't meet. And then they exhibited in 2000 for an exhibition called Quartet, and this was in Basel, and they finally met. So this, I think, is the second or third meeting between them. One of the other things that they have in common is that Hans-Ulrich Obrist has worked with both of them a lot, and he's interviewed both John and Ilya. And it's part of a series of interviews, the interview project it's called, that Hans-Ulrich has been doing. And he's basically done it for the last 20 years. There's 2,700 hours of interviews. And in all of that, when I was talking to Hans-Ulrich about this last night, he was saying that he thinks that this conversation is going to be really significant, even in comparison to all of the things that he's heard before. So I wonder if you can take the stage, Hans-Ulrich, and explain why.
Okay, thank you so much. And it's really our dream come true to have John and Ilya here tonight. Many, many thanks to Dasha, to Anton, to Olga, to all the teams at the Multimedia Museum at the Garage. And we're also very, very grateful, of course, to Emilia Kabakov, who is here. And as Kate said, it's somehow a very unrealized project to have actually Ilya and John in conversation, because they have had these many different contact zones, but there has never been a longer conversation. So we felt it could be wonderful, actually, and this is not going to be an interview, but to have a free jazz improvised conversation between the two of them tonight. And obviously the occasion are these two exhibitions in Moscow. Many of you will have seen the extraordinary Utopia and Reality show, Elisitsky, Ilya and Emilia Kabakov, last night, which brings together Ilya and Emilia's work with Elisitsky, an exhibition which started and was curated originally at the Farnaby Museum by Charles Esche, and here in Moscow is curated by Charles with Olga and also Dmitry Ozarkov and Daria Bubnova of the Hermitage Museum. And then at the same time, the exhibition at the Garage, which we hope you can all see tomorrow, of John, the 1+1=1 exhibition, which for the first time brings together this extraordinary group of works, double vision, double feature, double bill, and double play, which John has been creating. And as John told us, I like to create new meaning. The way to do that is to bring two things together, whether it's two words, two images, or image and word. And tonight, to bring together two people, two extraordinary artists, a very, very warm welcome to John Baldessari and Ilya Kabakov.
Значит, идя, ну, конечно, мы беседуем, естественно, не
вдвоем, где-то там. We are talking, not just two of us, but this public talk is in this room that is full of people. That's why we have to do everything we can to make it interesting for you. Not for us, but for you. That's why probably my first message My first suggestion would be the following. Both of us have the label. We are conceptualists. And of course, this term, unlike many other terms, is somehow vague, drifting, not quite clear and obvious. And I would like each of us, both of us, would comment on what you think conceptualism is and why this label is related to us. So what, John, what do you think about it?
I've always avoided that label conceptual art or conceptualist. I like to be called just an artist. I don't like to be called a California artist. I don't like to be called a West Coast artist. Artist seems sufficient, with a small A, not even a capital A. I think that term conceptualism, like a lot of labels, is an invention of journalists when something seems to emerge. I'm just talking in the art world. Journalists try to find a term to a commonality to describe various artists that seem to have something in common. Impressionism, expressionism, abstract expressionism, pop art, blah, blah, blah. And so a few artists came around. In my experience, it was New York, but we learned later that it was worldwide, of artists beginning to use text and language. I was living in National City. You don't know where this is, but if you know California, south of California, San Diego is the largest, the closest city to the Mexican border that you might recognize, but even further south, National City, kind of a ghetto, low-rent area. That's where I was doing art. And since there weren't any artists there, there were a couple of artists I knew, nobody was looking over my shoulder, nobody cared. I was teaching art in a high school to support myself. So I said, I can do pretty much what I want. I was in the midst, I guess, in terms of what artists were doing, sort of second generation abstract expressionism. And what you heard from the art public, that people looked at these works of art and said, my kid can do that, my kid can paint like that. So I thought, what would happen if I gave people what they want? So I had to figure out what they wanted, and probably something they could understand, not a bunch of paint smears. So I said, they probably read newspapers and read magazines and books, and in newspapers and magazines, there are probably photographs or they have a camera, so I will do this text on canvas or photographs on canvas. And since it's on canvas and people know that anything on canvas is art, then they'll say, it must be art. Well, it sounds foolproof, doesn't it? Didn't work. But then, in New York, people got wind of it, and I got grouped with a group of artists that call themselves conceptual artists. And I think my use of language was kind of playful, ironic. I'd been to the university. I didn't want to use academic language. I was tired of that. And I guess that, seemed to irritate quite a few of the New York artists. And they said, he's not a conceptual artist. He's a pop artist. And I felt pretty happy with that. And so that was my start.
Yes, it was a great pleasure for me to listen to your message, to your remark. And I want to mention that this referral to yourself, that I did it, I want to be an artist, it's a great opposition to what happened in Moscow, in our so-called conceptual circle. This idea was not mainly personal, it was in certain content group-like, it was discussed very seriously in our environment at that time. And I always want to use the pronoun we, unlike I, and I would like to refer to the memories of memoirs of Galina Ulalova, famous Russian belly dancer. She used to say, when we were dancing Odetta or swan, white swan, whatever, so I belong to this type of consciousness. That's why I want to say that this is very serious statement, very important, because it is not simply the direction, conceptualism, but this is certain point of view, vision in the system of historical retrospective positions of different artists in the history of art. In my understanding, I'd better say in our understanding, it's a special artistic wheel that could be changed four times. The first position could be called dogmatic one. This is the position to the art and to the life that is absolutely sure that what we do or what they do, we do some stuff, and this is absolutely correct, natural, and normal. Then, following that dogmatic view, revolutionary approach, romantic approach comes, that bursts out that dogma, that very hard confirmness that it should be like that. Then formalists come, mystics, symbolists, different forms, and we can find many names here, but this is the second view, second position. The third position, I would call it conceptual position. This is extreme focus to the fact that this is not one position, not one, not first, not second, but multiplicity of views. The artist conceptualist somehow can see his own art and everything that's going on around from position of many views, and these views are somehow structured, and they have vertical niches, complex, simple views, positions. So this is huge, polyphonic, orchestra-like group of positions. And the final one is designer approach, designer view. This is, I would say, context-less. Sweet, funny, merry ornamentality of the network that is put upon the art and the rest of it. In particular, I have to say that I and John, we belong to this almost passing away generation of, I'm sorry for that, conceptualists that relate to that distant, complex, multi-layer view to what they do and to the art generally. And now we came from the board of the ship to the ball, and now we come to this merry, sweet, dancing Europe designer world. Don't matter what they do. The most important to be entertained, to be funny, to be merry.
I think that sums it up. In the U.S., anytime anybody uses the "we," it means the imperial "we." It means me. We think, but it means I think. So we don't have this idea of a group of artists. It's very competitive, and artists are very jealous about the success of another artist. And it sort of reflects the world, I suppose, that we live in. That there is no communality in that we probably think we're outsiders and don't participate in society. I think there's a lot of pessimism. We worry a lot about the influx of money and how that might change art. I worry at night, 3 o'clock in the morning sometimes, that I'm not making art, I'm just making trinkets for rich people. So it's very hard to keep focused, and it's, I feel, as I think most of my peers feel, very much alone. I'm by myself. I don't participate in any group. And now I should ask Ilya a question. This is going to be very banal, but maybe it'll lead to something. William de Kooning, probably the most famous American abstract expressionism, was asked once what he thought about when he was standing in front of a canvas on an easel. He thought for a moment, he said, "I just want to take a nap." And Ilya, do you take naps?
Я хочу переспросить, куда взглянуть?
It has nothing to do with art. It has nothing to do with art. It means about, I suppose, it takes a lot of energy and courage to do art. And when I get out of my studio in the morning, and I'm thinking, uh-oh, I have to be brilliant again, to be a genius. I'd just rather take a nap. And eventually, of course, I have to face the music and think about doing it. I'm always interested in artist habits, you know, because we don't talk, you know. And a fellow conceptual artist and very good friend of mine, Lawrence Wiener, once described me in the press as saying, "John's a 9-to-5 artist." And I never thought about that before. I thought, well, is there any other way to be an artist? you know, I get up in the morning and go to my studio, and yeah, he was kind of right. I get there about 9, work till about 5 or 6, and I do that every day. And I said, but is that not normal? But he thought it was unusual. I remember the American artist Bruce Nauman saying, artists should go to the studio every day, even if they sweep the floor, because eventually they'll get bored. And to avoid boredom, you start playing. And art comes out of play. So that, you know, interested in your habits.
Thank you. I got it. First of all, I have to say that by saying I cannot identify myself as I for the whole period of my life. At least 3 times I was I, and these I were totally different. For example, I think that all the artists who are here today, they can distribute themselves, I would say, 3 age categories that are not linked to each other, not related. My first I, this is a young gentleman, young man, who is going to enter the artistic world and to do something around there, and incredible wish, desire he has, because he feels that he got into the carriage where everybody is already on the way. He's in the world where everything has already been done, and he simply starts opening his mouth and he's still silent. So that desire, crying, "I'm here as well, look at me, I'm dancing, I'm speaking, I'm here." So this incredible desire, wish to make the sound, to show your voice, this is the most important fundamental objective of the first level, first age, young man, first eye of the gentleman who see that the world is filled with masterpieces, artists, and he's not there yet. Nobody sees him, you know, to make pretty strange sound. It's important. So after that first sound comes, immediately after that comes the second stage. That means to participate in the modern art, contemporary art, modern life. It resembles like a railway station, you know, the first stage, you are still on the platform and you want to get in that carriage that is departing right now. And if you're lucky, you get into that carriage, into that train, and you feel that you are among those like who are like you. So participation in the contemporary artistic activity leads to the feeling that we know each other, we are the group, there was nobody before us and will be nobody after. So we are in that carriage, in that train, we know each other and we would like to exist together. If you manage to stay there, to stuck there, to get the answers from all the partners, passengers, everybody who are around you, then you perform your second objective, and that means the average age, mid-age. And finally, the third eye comes, and you feel that carriage where you were happily traveling, suddenly you see that it is somewhere in the dead end, abandoned place, and you see that other trains, other carriages are passing by and nobody is looking to you from there. So this very frightening position, feeling of the third age where the others are passing away, going with huge speed, velocity far away, and it leads to you to the new understanding in that third eye. Some of artists who come to this third age, they do the same. Some repeat what Renoir used to do. He performed the same naked ladies, huge amounts of them. The second one maybe does nothing. The fourth invents something different. And probably for the first time I will tell you now about myself, my eye. Suddenly you start feeling that your carriage, and you being in that carriage, you go back with huge speed, and now you see 19th century, 18th century, with huge velocity, you're rushing to some artists who appear to be not your friends, but let's say some examples. You see them in that retrospective way back. You see totally different company. You're not totally irrelevant. You're not interested. What's going on in that fast express trains? Probably I'm speaking too much, and I want to say, ask John what he thinks about it.
It brings to mind, I think I heard that term in some writing about you. The American philosopher Edward Said wrote a book called Late Style and put forward this idea that creative people in their life come to a point where I guess they have the ability to use every instrument in the orchestra, you know, rather than, you know, a piano quartet or piano and bass or whatever, but in full command of the principles of making art at their command. And I thought that, I think he's pretty right about that. I feel like that I have a lot, I've all my life, at least all my waking hours, without the naps, my waking hours, I think about art, looking about art, making decisions about art, having to put those decisions into practice. I think I'm pretty good at it. I begin to trust myself, and I'm really curious about what I'm going to do next. But I guess we're going to go through this all night, you know, between we and I, because it's just two different ways of life. I don't have that communal feeling with other artists in the carriage. I've heard of other models, pretty well-known young artist right now who is one of my studios, was one of my students. He had a model, which I think about. He thought about a pyramid. You know, you start down at the bottom of the pyramid, and at the top of the pyramid are all the famous artists, and you gradually work your way up as those famous artists drop off, either by non-recognition or they die or whatever. But eventually you'll work up to the top. But you see, again, that's about a single person, isn't it? So we just have these different models in her mind.
I would like to approach this topic from totally other sides. The roles of museums and the importance of the past and the valuable in those museums. I belong to the generation that was studied in the art school in the 1950s, and it was the time of total, terrible animalization from the word animal of the world, of the community. So I lived in the hostel and my colleagues were fiercely happy, ruining the sculptures we had in the classrooms, and they crushed all those marble heads and figures. That sadism, that disgust feeling of the world to everything, to the rest, to your own profession. So that feeling was extremely strong. I can compare my generation with, literally, with the Mowgli. We were like Mowglis. We were jumping from the bench to the bench of the tree, and we were fierce and absolutely nomadic. And in that cartoon, there is one episode. Mowgli looks behind the bushes and he sees some ruins. He tries to touch these ruins, marble sculptures, half ruined, and in his totally animal-like head, he has some genes of consciousness, of feeling of human, being a human, and since that moment, he wakes up a little bit. This is absolute metaphoric description of that state of the Soviet children in those times. So that Mowgli from Rudyard Kipling. So we were Mowglis visiting museums, visiting art exhibitions, because they were tiny islets of culture and civilization that still managed to survive behind the Iron Curtain. Now, recollecting some Soviet scenarios with some idyllic atmosphere, but you should never forget that atmosphere of fear, tribal life. That was the essence of our life. That's why our works, artistic works, simultaneously, they kept the relics of some models of education, ideals that came to us from our teachers. Not those who were in painting. It was very miserable trade, you know. But the art historians who were studying that subject. And in the air was always the atmosphere of super I being ideal. So Raphael already paints something at age 25, Madonna. And what did you do, idiot, bloody idiot? So all the time we had some examples of certain ideal, perfect cultural messages and world's images. That's how, paradoxically, in those wild Mowglis, they tried to train the feeling of perfect, where you have to eagerly move to. So that's Wimbledon, somewhere in the air, it was above us. Why am I talking about that? To us it was very important. The question is not what I did, or as John says, I come into my studio, I feel happy, or I would like to have a nap. You know, we always had that feeling of responsibility, frightening responsibility. What is your participation in that cultural process? What is your place? It may seem strange, but we felt that we were lonely as well. We didn't feel in that complex of frustrations of because of that masterpieces that were created before us. So that ratio to work with cultural gene, dynamics of cultural development. It was a huge gap between the art and culture. That huge gap it took place in avant-garde time when responsibility shifted to yourself. What I did, and I probably think it was quite symbolic, and we observe full-fledged the results of this activity that is not related to any culture at all. John?
Well, one word in what you just said struck me, fear. I don't think artists in the U.S. ever feel that. They might feel fear of not being acknowledged, but not fear from society in any way. I think what artists fear in the U.S. is of just not being noticed and nobody caring. I guess it's a kind of fear. We sort of are touching here on art education, I suppose. I taught all my life from preschool to juvenile delinquents to university to art school, so I think I'm pretty well aware of the teaching process. I guess I've come to the conclusion, not just now, but early on, that art can't be taught, but we do have art schools with the assumption that art can be taught. So I'm interested in that space between what schools think and what I personally think, and I can operate pretty well in that area. So maybe the question, Ilya, I'd like to ask of you, do you think art can be taught? Do we need art schools?
Art schools, yes, we do need them, definitely. As well as we need music schools for those who try to play violin, piano. For hockey players, they also are to be trained. You know, school is definitely needed, absolutely. But in the school, you are to distinguish, differentiate two things. These are professional skills, let's say in music, you know, to take the baton or vibration, the sound, whatever. And the second, we have to train in parallel, and this is not less important. This is future participation of the artist in the cultural process. This is one of the most important issues. To surround the students with aura of the world culture, not simply, you know, talented, not talented, inventive, not inventive. What participation could be? This is huge responsibility. What would be the participation of this particular student would be? What would be his place in the cultural process? He should be intelligent, smart, educated, love the past, and to feel, you know, like a transmitter from past to the future. Each artist is a sort of bridge. This bridge links from cultural values from past to the future.
Yeah, there's a great difference I see here. Right now, we have a phenomenon in art education of graduate programs in art to get a graduate degree. And I would like to think, and at its best, I think that it probably does obtain that 2 year work, 2, 3, 4 years of study are going to help that student be a better artist. But I think what the student thinks is that I'm going to meet a lot of people that can help me in my career of being an artist. You know, I'm going to meet artists that I would never meet on my own, and they can help me. You know, there's this kind of careerism going on, it's rather sad. And when I was teaching at a very well-known art school, California Institute of the Arts, or called CalArts, we had so little distrust in traditional art teaching that we didn't even have a curriculum. Students could take any courses they wanted to. They didn't even have to show up. I was in charge of inviting artists to the schools to talk or give lectures or what have you. Because my idea was, yes, art, I don't think art can be taught, but it might be good to have artists hanging around. And maybe by watching these artists and talking to them, you know, that would do something. But I had artists, and very well artists, like Carl Andre or Solowit, that wouldn't even come to the school. They didn't believe in school. And in a way I saw that, there was a bar nearby, and I had, well, will you just stay there in the bar, and I'll bring students to you. And that worked. But I don't know where you want to go on with this idea of how if teaching art or art can be taught, but I'm willing to go on if you want to, or we can switch the topic.
If you don't mind, I would like to continue this topic of education. Because I graduated art school that was the relic of the classical education of the 19th century. So our horrible teachers were usually losers in art, but still they trained us, presenting us canonic rules of making compositions, drawings and pictures that were accepted as a rule pretty long ago in 19th, 20th centuries. Of course, we were totally away from the contemporary scenario. We didn't see anything started from Russian avant-garde, absolutely nothing. And of course, we had no idea about art in the West. But I think one big plus of our education advantage is the ability, if you have something in your mind and automatically you can represent it using your hand. This skill of professional transformation from the fantasy to the hand reaction, it was, you know, like a nail in the brain for many years, almost 15 years of training. It was known quite smoothly, fluently. Very important that if later on you have any ideas, you have that terrible fear that I don't know how to do it, how to make it, because it's also frightening. It's like in playing violin, the same like in theater world, etc. You have to see in reality, in implementation, how it will be done, how that will be done that your fantasy or imagination speaks about. But it was not the training of the artist. It was like some technical part, skill of your hand, I would say. Since avant-garde, you know, switched to the plane of the picture, they stopped using this. The depth of the picture, it's just the education, because artists can make the painting on the surface and to see it in the depth, in the perspective. Unfortunately, as we travel a lot, you know, it doesn't exist almost at all. Everybody is making anything on the surface. In those places which we visited, students, they simply don't know what to do, how to see it. He sits in front of you, he tells you, I want, I have some ideas, but they cannot simply transmit it, transfer it into the canvas, into the paper. They simply are not trained, as the violin player cannot, don't know how to move the baton. So this is the calamity of the modern education, disappearance of academic canon style. It doesn't mean that for lifelong they should paint Venus or whatever, but they should have this practice in hands.
Sounds like I'm going to come off as the bad guy, but I'll continue. CalArts started in 1970, and it probably became the most well-known art school in the U.S. When we started, you have to get what is called accreditation by a committee of professors from other universities and so on, that you can grant degrees and that are recognized. And we passed everything except we didn't have any courses on how to draw. So we, of course, installed a course in how to draw, and the way we sold that was to have 3 hours a day, a room where students could draw from the model. We didn't have an instructor. We just said, here, here's a pencil, draw the model. On the other hand, we had 26 portable television recording devices. Sony had just come out with something called the Sony PortaPack. We had a very famous video artist there, Namjoon Paik, you might have heard of, teaching. and he made sure there were plenty of videos, video apparatus. The school was sort of split down the middle. On one hand, people that did deal with, you know, traditional painting, drawing, and so on. And on the other hand, and I was there, I'm saying, Alan Capro, the Fluxus artists, people like that, that were suggesting that there were other ways to do art. We didn't exactly know what those ways might be, but there might be other ways to do art. So I think that still continues today in art schools. You have a divide. I can go on with that, and I probably will, but now I want to say something about the cultural impact of where artists live and operate. I live in California, more properly in Los Angeles. Los Angeles is not a European city like San Francisco or New York. It's a relatively new city. We tear down old buildings, we don't keep them. I live in what is considered a very old house, and I can get a historical marker on it if I want, but I've avoided it. You know why? Because it was built in 1930. Pretty old house. The good thing, when I say we don't have we don't live in a European city, for art is that we don't have, let's say like somebody in Italy walking by a statue of Michelangelo. We don't have that. You know, those artists, I suspect, feel the pressure of history on their shoulders. Most art students in Los Angeles, their knowledge of art history might go back, at best, 5 years, if you're lucky. So we have to emphasize art history a lot. The good thing about that is that there's and not just for the visual arts, you know, for design, music, the arts in general, is I think there's this condition of why not? Why shouldn't we try this? Who's going to stop us? You know, there's this constant feeling of freedom and experimentation. I remember in the late 60s being at a well-known artist bar in New York with a lot of European artists and artists from New York. I was the only California artist or West Coast artist present. And at that point, I guess we still had that idea of modernism, that art got better and better and better, which, you know, doesn't seem to obtain now. But at any rate, we're all talking very excitedly about different art ideas, and I came up with an idea, and all of a sudden everybody stopped talking. It was just, they could hear a pin drop. And I said, well, what did I say? And then somebody said, well, that wouldn't fit very well into art history, would it? And I thought, who cares? But you see, so there's an attitudinal one that we get from where we live, and on to you.
Just to say, we have about 10 minutes.
Wonderful topic, great topic. And continuing that, I want to comment on the very important issue. I think this is burning issue for every artist who is here. And this issue can be formulated like this. What is the relation between the local art and international art? So you can participate, you can do something locally, you can play football in your own yard, backyard, but how would I play if I'm invited to play in Bavaria or Brasilia field? If I play tennis well, what does my play mean if I play at Wimbledon? So how this communication is performed between the local being of the artist in his, you know, local community, region, city, or maybe even in the country, and how it can be interrelated with the global art, international art, because the history of art, although it's, you know, spread around to different regions, etc., but still there is certain international level that in principle should be reached by any local artist. What do you think about it? Or maybe it's not a problem at all. Or maybe it's not a problem at all. Or maybe it's not a problem at all.
How do I answer that? Living in National City, the only art center was Los Angeles. That was, you know, the one of the big cities of the U.S. And there were art galleries there, and I would periodically go up there with my truck filled with my paintings and trying to get galleries interested in my work that I might get an exhibition. And no interest. And one gallerist said something to me that stuck in my head. He said, "Well, you know, you're more a European artist." And I thought, "Well, that's interesting." And I thought, "Well, it's true. I'm a first generation American. My parents were from Europe. Maybe that somehow influences my work in a way. I don't know." But then a very famous European dealer, Conrad Fischer from Dusseldorf, had heard about me and visited to me, and it wanted me to show with him. And I think in that year, I had 7 gallery shows in Europe, none in the US. I don't know what that says about me, but it says that somebody from California had some influence in Europe without knowing it.
Yes, I think I understand it very well. And I want to cover also an important issue that bothers everyone or maybe bothers nobody. This is a topic about the visitor, the spectator. Does the artist react to what is he's seen by the visitor, or it can be totally ignored? I asked a friend of mine, how do you see your own, how do you perceive your own visitor, your spectator? Maybe you have to listen to him. He was terrified and he asked, "What spectator and what visitor? Visitor is I, myself. They should took my position and look at my work with my eyes, through my eyes." To me, it's absolutely unacceptable, because I think there is no any listening of the visitors to the artist. I think what exists is the intelligent, smart, interesting person, not totally interested in the artist, who walks around in the museum, watches one master after the other, one masterpiece after the other. He sees, he compares. What exists for him is a panoramic view of the highest quality, and the best criteria is getting into the museum. This is a person very well informed, educated, intelligent, with a knowledge of history of art. It approaches your painting somewhere in the exhibition, and he compares it with that panorama that already exists in his or her hand, that library of values that he knows very well. Let's, like any specialist expert in music, he knows how Richter plays. That's why he clearly recognizes that the other musician is far away from Richter. So to ignore, we cannot ignore such visitor, because if you think that he would gladly listen to you, but no, you are already somewhere in the backlist, because you are not in the criteria. You don't reach that threshold that exists in his health. That means your painting is failure, and what you do it for yourself, no, it's not the result.
I think that we could walk away, and you two could carry on talking all night, and you wouldn't even notice that we'd gone, would you?
Завершать, иначе мы можем говорить всю ночь. Ну, давайте делать то, что мы
говорим.
Вопросы эти очень серьезные.
I think these issues are very serious. Maybe, of course, we can interrupt at any moment. At any moment, if you like. So I would like to repeat once again that this issue of a visit of spectator is of absolute importance for the artist, like for musician, because you should not hope that your work would be loved if it doesn't reach that critical threshold that was bred up by the history of art. I think this is absolute requirement. The history of art is very cruel thing, and to have a hope that it will be changed soon and our time is a unique time, no, you are naive if you think like this, because everything that fails and goes away through the from the history of art, it never exists.
Yeah, at the garage, I got about one and a half to 2 years, got very much involved with art history, because at one point I actually wanted to be an art historian, and I did graduate work in art history. I thought I would teach art history. I thought I would write about art. But then I decided I probably was a better artist than I would be a critic or a teacher of art history. At any rate, most of my work since I became known as an artist has dealt with what we call appropriation, using art from the culture around us or information from the culture around us and bringing it together. And this last body of work, I decided I would go back into art history, but not, but still sampling or appropriating. I would go to books in art history and photograph the reproductions in the books, like I would photograph reproductions in a newspaper. So it was just a shift in territory, but not in process. These works in the garage, they deal with art history. A lot of them deal with trying to slow the spectator down so they don't think that, you know, that's Renoir, that's Matisse, that's, you know, blah, blah, blah. You know, I think the last survey I heard was the average museum visitor in the U.S., I can't speak about other countries, 7 minutes per painting, or not per painting, per work of art. You don't have much time, you know, to get a conversation going there with a spectator. So, you know, you have to think about how do you do that? How do you get a conversation going? Okay, but anyway, what I've done in this show, in the garage, was to be like, I call it being like Dr. Frankenstein, taking one artist and trying to fuse that artist with another artist and creating a third artist. Hence the title, One Plus One, one artist plus another artist, doesn't give you two artists, but it gives you a new artist. So one plus one equals one. So when you see these works of art, you have to guess what the artists are that I'm sampling. It's a guessing game. You have to really think about art history. It really helps if you know art history. One-fourth of those works I showed in my gallery in New York, I think there were 15 works. A former curator of Museum of Modern Art, he was able to guess 9 of them, and that was the most, I think. So I deal with art history. I have no argument with art history.
So, Hans Ulrich, is there something that you would like to say? Because I realize that this is very unusual for you to be sitting and listening to two artists in conversation rather than interviewing.
It's an immense privilege, and I think we should, you know, because we are running out of time, I think it's end of chapter one, and we hopefully can continue this conversation very, very soon. So many, many thanks to Ilya, many, many thanks to John, many, many thanks to you all. Thank you.